Good evening and welcome to our Window to the World event. My name is Fatih Nyaro. I am from Burkina Faso and I'm currently a student at Western Kentucky University. The Window to the World is a concept put together by current international students at Western Kentucky University, and it consists for them to present, you know, about the culture, to share presentations about the different home countries. And tonight we're going to have three main presenters: Ali Noti from Democratic Republic of Congo, Delisha from the Bahamas, and myself from Burkina Faso. But before we get into the presentations, please allow me to say thank you to all the Kentuckian institutions and the individuals who've successfully put this event together here at Western Kentucky University. I think of John, Diana, Savannah, Katie, Lauren, and all the GLIA staff, and also all the international students who've accepted to present, to share about their cultures with us tonight. These individuals have worked day and night to put this successful event together. Tonight, our first presenter, Ali Noti, is from the Democratic Republic of Congo. He's a student of international affairs and political science, and he's going to share about the DRC. Please welcome Ali Noti.
Thank you so much for that beautiful introduction. Again, my name is Ali Noti Malebo, and I'm from the Democratic Republic of the Congo. I'm a student there at Western Kentucky University, and I'm majoring in international affairs and political science. So to begin, I'm going to share a little bit about the DRC, and I'm going to play the video. At the end of the video, I'm going to allow questions. If you have any questions for those who are watching us on YouTube or on Facebook, please feel free to ask those questions in the chat below. So I'll go ahead and play the video and go from there.
Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for having me here today. Again, my name is Ali Noti, and today we will going to talk about DRC Congo. I will go ahead and share my screen. I'll go ahead and share my screen, and we'll go from there. Awesome. Welcome to the Democratic Republic of Congo. So before we begin, I will going to give you an overview what Congo is. So the Democratic Republic of Congo is a country located in Central Africa, which was known as Zaire. It was before 1997. So the Congo is the second largest country in Africa. At the same time, it is the 11th largest country in the world, with a population of over 100 million people. The official language in Congo is French, but there are other languages that are recognized or other popular languages known in Congo, which include Kikongo, Lingala, Chiluba, and Swahili. We also have a lot of tribal languages. So in general, in Congo, there are more than 300 languages. Natural resources. DRC is one of the leading countries in terms of minerals. It is the largest producer of cobalt, diamond, and copper. It also produces uranium, as the same was used in making bombs that were used to attack Japan in 1945 by the US. Despite the fact that it has all of these natural resources, the leading cause of the people in the country are still suffering and fighting against themselves. And all of these are happening since the time of colonization. So, and if we talk about the thing that is happening in Congo, we cannot talk or mention a lot without talking about their political view. The DRC has not had the best experience in terms of politics, because there are still civil wars since 1996. People still fighting among themselves. So the government itself is semi-presidential, as it is led by the president and prime minister. So which also may cause a big conflict, especially if both of them have different political opinions. At the moment, the president is Felix Tshisekedi, who was elected in the controversial election in 2018 through the Union of the Democracy and Social Progress. So whenever all those conflicts happen in the country, it causes a big problem that can affect a lot of people from almost everywhere. And this problem is the refugee crisis. Now we may hear like, what is a refugee? Let's see. What's a refugee? A refugee is someone who have been forced to leave their home country in order to escape war, persecution, or natural disaster. So basically, a refugee has a well-founded religion, but return to their home country. So now, the of this crisis, they talk like, what exactly is how this means to Congo? DRC is the home of one of the most dangerous crises to humans, especially in the east of the country, in the eastern Congo. The conflict mainly comes from the fact there is a high rate of poverty among the people, which is to those Congolese. And war and placement, which simply call them to move to neighbor countries. I can give you an example, a great example. The crisis that happened in Kivu. The Kivu conflict that started in 1996 after the genocide incidents in Rwanda. It is one of the worst conflicts, considering that it involved the army militia member from Rwanda and Uganda. Because of that, Congo has the large peacekeeping missions from the United Nations. Since its independence from the Belgium in 1960, the country has never experienced any peaceful political tradition. And because of that, it caused a lot of Congolese to flee in a neighboring country such as Uganda, Kenya, Tanzania, and they lived in those countries as refugees. Now, we may be like, what is the main cause of the conflict that is happening in Congo? The war in DRC has no single cause, because it caused by complex natural of causes that is stem from the pre-colonial. The fact that the East is rich, because there's a lot of natural resources, and because of those natural resources, people from the outside want to take over, want to control those resources. They want to manage them. At the same time, the greed for power is also a major cause of war or of the conflict between in the Congo. So as you can see, like I mentioned before, there is a lot of reasons that caused the war in DRC. And also the military is also a cause, because because the government cannot really control the army. So that caused those military to do whatever they can. Imagine if you are not getting pay in your job. So it lead in any situation that nobody can believe. So let's move on. So that is the end of my presentation. I just share the cause of the problem. Now I will going to share like a personal solution to this problem, because I personally believe that every problem must have a solution. And if you are not a part of the solution, you are a part of the problem. With what is happening in Congo, personally, I think the best solution is to stop people from overseas to take control of the country, which simply means those people from the outside should not have the power to control the country or to make decision to locals or to Congolese. Instead, the government should take control of the resources that they already have and provide a lot of jobs to local communities, to Congolese, to people who are living in the country. And that can be done by providing a lot of jobs, resources, taking people to school, support young people, and all of those opportunities. With that, I think Congo will be an independent country, and everybody will be peaceful in that country. So that is just a short presentation that I wanted to share today about the Congo. And if you have any question, please feel free to reach out to us. Thank you so much.
Yes, again, if there's anybody who have any question, for those who are watching us from YouTube or Facebook, please feel free to ask. If there's not any question, then we will move forward.
All right. Thank you so much, Alinoti, for this wonderful presentation about the Democratic Republic of Congo. Our next presenter is from the beautiful island of the Bahamas. She studies political science, and she's going to share some aspects of the beauty in the Bahamas with us. Please welcome Delisha Bo.
Good evening. My name is Delisha Bo. I'm going to share with you a few things that I find interesting about my country. I put together a video. Thank you.
Thank you.
Now I will answer any questions that anyone has. Okay, our first question, what is your favorite thing about living there? My favorite thing would probably have to be the food and the people, because everyone here is just like a big family. So you go anywhere and you know everybody. Second question, what is something you'd want everyone to know about your home? Well, it is always very hot here. So if you're looking for a place to go during the winter or to have fun during the summer, this is always the place to come. Okay, what is my favorite food? My favorite Bahamian dish would have to be peas and rice and crack conch with macaroni. If there are no more questions, we can move on.
All right. Thank you so much, Delisha, for this wonderful presentation. We've discovered some of the beauties of the Bahamas, and I hope our viewers have enjoyed this video. The next presentation is about Burkina Faso, where I am from, and I've put together some, you know, a video, and I'm going to share that with you all.
Hi everyone, my name is Fatin. I am from Burkina Faso, and today I'm here to talk about my country. I'll share some interesting historical facts about Burkina Faso and also some of our tradition. So let me begin by sharing my screen with you all. All right, so Burkina Faso stands for Land of Upright Men. It's a combination of some of our local languages back there. And here we have a flag. The red represents the blood shed by the people of Burkina Faso for the freedom of the country. And the yellow star represents the resources. We do have a lot of gold, and the green represents the vegetation of the country. So this is the map of Burkina Faso, with the capital city here, right in the middle. And I'm from here, Tétéku. And we do have some of our neighboring countries, Niger in the east, Benin in the southeast, and Ghana in the south, Cote d'Ivoire in the south also, and Mali in the northwest of Burkina Faso. And some important historical dates. The country was created in 1919 by the French colonizers. And in 1960, we got our independence from France. And 1983, there was a revolution in Burkina Faso. And this is the guy that led the revolution, Thomas Sankara. And he's the one also who changed the name of the country from Upper Volta. You know, at the creation, the French colonizer gave us the name Haute Volta in French and Upper Volta in English. And when Thomas Sankara came to power in 1983, he decided to change the name of the country from Haute Volta to Burkina Faso, because for him, Haute Volta did not have any meaning. It didn't make any sense to the people of the country. So he changed the name, and we became Burkina Faso, Land of Upright Men, Land of the Honest People. And it's also under Thomas Sankara that, you know, Burkina Faso became very well known in Africa and also around the world. And Thomas Sankara is the one who succeeded in making Burkina Faso a self-sufficient country in terms of food. We were even exporting food to some European countries such as Italy under Thomas Sankara. And education also, you know, he built a lot of schools, he built a lot of hospitals and provided healthcare system that was beneficial to a lot of people in Burkina Faso back then. And his vision for the country, for Burkina Faso and for Africa at large, did not please a lot of people internally but also externally. So Thomas Sankara would be assassinated in 1987 in a coup d'etat, and Blaise Compaoré is the one who is supposed to be behind the coup, and he became president from 1987 to 2014. And in 2014, Blaise Compaoré tried to modify the constitution of the country in order for him to be able to stay in power for forever, that, like, you know, many African leaders still do, unfortunately. But, you know, there was a popular uprising in 2014, and the people of Burkina Faso was, enough is enough, you've been in power for 27 years, and it's been 27 years of assassination. Over 200 people have been assassinated under Blaise Compaoré. And it's been 27 years of corruption. It's been 27 years of poverty, of poor leadership. And the people were like, enough is enough. And this is the mobilization in only the capital city, Ouagadougou. Over 2 million people gathered, you know, in the capital city on October 30th, asking for his departure. And he, you know, left the country and is now living in Ivory Coast with his in-laws, because his wife is from that country. So talking about the educational system, we do have 40 levels, and kids start going to school, kindergarten, and they generally enter kindergarten when they're 3 years old, and they stay there for 3 years, and then they move to primary school, and from primary school, where they spend 6 years, they move to high school. It's a combination. Back home in Burkina Faso, we do have middle school and high school all together. So they move to high school, and from high school they move to university. And this is an amphitheater in Burkina Faso, and it's common to have over 3,000 students in an amphitheater with professors standing up in front of the class with a microphone and lecturing the students. And this is common in law department and economics department. So yeah, 3,000 students in a classroom. Now let's talk about gender role. Men in Burkina Faso are supposed to be the main provider for the family, and they are the ones who make the decision, and the rest of the family just have to follow the rules imposed, you know, by the man. And women are supposed to stay at home and do the housework, and they're also seen as, you know, the ones who they're just there to make babies and take care of their husband and the rest of the family. But it's good to know that, it's good to mention that this is true, particularly in rural Burkina Faso, in traditional, Burkina Faso. Because the reality is that nowadays we do have, a lot of women in government. We do have at least 5 women in our current government. We have women in parliament. We do have women professors, women doctors. So more and more people are sending women, girls to school. And as I said, I do insist these things are true, particularly in rural areas amongst people who are not very well educated. But because they are the majority, so yeah, it kind of, this used to be, I would say, the currency of Burkina Faso long, long, long ago, those seashells. And nowadays they used as, they used by fortune tellers to tell people their future, what's coming up next in their lives. And I don't know, I've never used it, but some people still believe that, and they would consult fortune tellers to find out about their future and how to deal with, you know, stuff and get better opportunities. In terms of food, we do eat a lot of chicken in Burkina Faso. I would say chicken, rice, and beans are considered to be the main dishes in Burkina Faso. We do have chicken in kind of every food. And the economy of the country is mainly based on agriculture. We used to be the first producer of cotton in Africa until recently, when Mali took over. And we also produce a lot of gold. And we are the fourth producer of gold in Africa, after South Africa, Ghana, Mali, and then Burkina Faso. And as I said, breeding is also, you know, considerable in the country. We have a lot of cow, a lot of sheep, a lot of goats, a lot of chicken, and tourism also contribute to the economy of the country. And people sometimes, when they want to go for a safari in Africa, they choose Eastern African countries such as Kenya and Tanzania. Burkina Faso can also be a good destination, you know, for safari, for tourism in Africa. And this is a beautiful view of the capital city, Ouagadougou. Here also, it's Ouagadougou, the capital city. It's beautiful. And, you know, if you're wondering, you're considering wondering about accommodation when you decide to visit Burkina Faso, no worries. We do have very nice hotels, 5-star hotels, with nice swimming pools, like you can see on that screen. So if you this is your concern, we do have everything to make you at ease, to give you the comfort you need for your stay in Burkina Faso. So thank you very much for watching. And if you do have any questions, please feel free to ask. I'm here to answer. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you so much for watching this little video about Burkina Faso. If you have any question, please feel free to ask. I'm here to answer. What is your favorite thing about living there? Well, I would say Burkina Faso is like a big family. Like Delisha also mentioned, we live like in the same community. Solidarity is very well developed. That is something I really like about Burkina Faso. You cannot be, you know, in difficulty and not be able to find somebody who is willing to provide the support, the help you need, you know, to get through what you're going through. So this is something I really like about Burkina Faso. What is something you would want everyone to know about your home? Like the name indicates, Burkina Faso is very well known to be the land of, you know, the upright men, the land of the honest people. And I would want everybody to remember, you know, of Burkina Faso as the land of upright men. We, you know, we do have some few individuals who can do some bad stuff, but in general, you know, Burkina Faso is a very welcoming country. It's very hospitality is, you know, given very high esteem in the country, and people are really, really honest. Next question. What do you love the most about your home? I think, like I said, the solidarity part of Burkina Faso is something I really like. Yeah, there is no way for an individual in Burkina Faso, for example, to experience something like homelessness. This is something we do not know in Burkina Faso. Although it's a poor country, people always, you know, come together and provide, you know, and share the little they have with others. And this is something that helps us build a community, and a loving and caring community, so that, you know, everybody, every single individual can prosper in that country. This is something I really enjoy about Burkina Faso. My favorite food currently, since I'm in the United States, I would say broccoli. Broccoli is my favorite food here in the U.S. But in Burkina Faso, I really love you know, eating rice with peanut butter sauce. And hopefully, we will have the opportunity to get together when COVID is gone, or, you know, when we can get together, and I will cook that dish and share it with the community here at Western Kentucky University and in Bowling Green in general. When did women start getting more responsibilities in Burkina Faso? This is a wonderful question. And I would say, you know, the leader I mentioned, the leader who did the revolution in Burkina Faso, Thomas Sankara, is actually the one who promoted, you know, women, women's rights in Burkina Faso. He is the one who started, you know, appointing women as ministers. and as head of, you know, department in public service. So I'd say it's under the revolution from starting in 1983 that we started having more women, you know, in political life, in public affairs in Burkina Faso. What is the main religion in Burkina Faso? I would say, you know, in Burkina Faso, there is a saying that we do have some people who are Muslims, some people who are Christians, but everybody is African. What do I mean by this? We do have, you know, our African traditions, African religions, and a lot of people still practice those practices. But officially, 62% of the population are Muslims, and we do have the remaining as Christians. Next question. If each of you could only use one or two words to describe your home country, what would they be? Burkina Faso would be the land of upright men. What about the Congo?
Oh, thank you so much, Patin, for that wonderful presentation. So if I could describe the DRC in one word, I could just say it is the richest country in the world. So just rich.
Thank you. Thank you, Alinoti. What about the Bahamas?
If I could describe the Bahamas in one word, I would probably say relaxing.
Okay, can all of the presenters talk about their favorite foods? Let's start with Alinoti. I think I already talked about mine. It is rice with peanut butter sauce. So Alinoti, what is your favorite food?
Oh, that's a great question. So basically my favorite food is fufu, which we also called ugali. Mm-hmm. So that is my favorite. Since back home up to here, still my favorite.
Thank you. Thank you, Alinoti. What about Delisha?
I answered earlier. It's peas and rice and cracked conch, which is basically beaten and fried conch. Mm-hmm.
All right. To all the presenters, what do you love the most about your home?
Basically, on my end, there's a lot of things that I love about Congo. But I'm going to share one that I really love is the hospitality. People are so nice and able to take care for each other. So children do not belong only to their parents or to their to the one family, but all the children belong to the communities, which simply means it is my responsibility to take care of my neighbors, to take care of other kids in the communities. So that is something that I really love about DRC.
Great. Delisha.
I responded earlier to this question. I really love that everyone here is like a big family. You can go anywhere and they would take you in and feed you. I love that we're all just friendly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I also shared mine. It's that commonality that we have in Burkina Faso. Like, you know, the two others have also mentioned, We live in solidarity. We help each other. There is no way for an individual, you know, to lack food or a place to sleep, because you know, we take care of each other. We take care of our neighbors. We take care, you know, of our cousins, our nephews, and so on and so forth. So that is something that I really like about Burkina Faso. Any other question?
Any other questions for us?
So, well, if there is no other question, I would love to thank, you know, everybody who was able to make it tonight to this Window to the World event. And if you're watching the replay, do not forget to ask questions, comment below, and share with your network. Thank you so much for attending this, and we hope to see you next time. Thank you. Have a good night.